for which the URL is listed here at the bottom of the slide. The UCF ECHO AAC for Adults series is part of the UCF AAC Collaborative, and it is made possible by funding that's provided from the WITH Foundation. A few reminders for today's session. We are going to follow the format listed here on the slide. We'll have our speaker discuss best practices in today's topic area. There'll be a Q&A portion following today's content presentation. There'll be opportunities to ask questions about specific cases, and we will conclude with a group discussion of the cases that we've discussed. In terms of webinar tips, we would like to remind everybody to please close any applications that may use additional bandwidth or resources on your computer so that you can best see the presentation. As I mentioned just a moment ago, there will be time for questions and answers after the presentation, but please do put any questions that arise in the chat. We will be monitoring the chat and distributing those questions to Dr. Kent-Walsh at the end of the session. We ask that you please remain muted during the presentation, and of course, you're welcome to unmute for the Q&A portion during our group discussion. Throughout the course of this series, we are collecting feedback about the efficacy of this professional development training and how it impacts provider confidence and competence in AAC service delivery. To participate in this survey, you need to be 18 years or older, have registered for the training, and fall into one of the allied health professional or related fields. Participation in the survey is always optional, but we do invite you to be part of this data collection opportunity as it helps us understand how best to meet your needs in professional development service delivery. So without further ado, we would like to introduce our topic for today, which is building partner support for augmentative and alternative communication. We are thrilled to have Dr. Jennifer Kent-Walsh here with us speaking on this topic. Dr. Kent-Walsh is an ASHA Fellow, a professor here in the School of CSD at the University of Central Florida. She's also the director of the FAST Atlantic Region AT Demonstration Center and the Associate Dean for Research in the College of Health Professions here at UCF. Dr. Kent-Walsh collaborates with Dr. Binger, who was our guest speaker last week for our ECHO session. And together they have worked over the years to develop and evaluate interventions that are designed to improve language and communication outcomes for children who use AAC. As you can see, Dr. Kent-Walsh is currently funded by the Chelsea G. Magruder Foundation, the FAST Center, and NIDCD through the National Institutes of Health. So without further ado, welcome Dr. Kent-Walsh, and we are thrilled to have you with us today.
Thank you. I think that that slide gives away my Zoom uniform, it seems. My Zoom background, my consistent UCF background, and just the ongoing black. But now that we've shifted into November from October, I might need to shift to something a little more festive. But I'm going to go ahead and share here. Trying to make you all a little bit more visible. Am I good for the slides? Are you able to see them okay? Okay, perfect. Thank you. Well, I am very happy to talk today about building support for AAC, certainly something that has been near and dear to my heart and our team's heart for a very long time in working with individuals who use AAC and remembering the full context of the lives of these clients that we work with and all of the people that are important to them in their everyday lives. So lots of kudos and shout outs here to be given. As Julie mentioned, I work very closely with Kathy Binger, who we heard from last week in our ongoing program of research across our two institutions at UCF and the University of New Mexico. And you see our wonderful colleagues that we also partner with. And we're so thrilled that the team at UCF has really grown to an incredible size and might, I would say, over the years in the area of AAC. So working very closely with Nancy Harrington on the research that you heard some about last week from Kathy, if you were here to join us, and also on Carolyn, with Carolyn on related projects and things like the ECHO initiative that we're fortunate to be partaking in today. And we're thrilled to have Julie, who's on board with us, as well as other clinical faculty and academic faculty with related interests in AAC. So huge shout out to them, because much of what we discuss is in good credit, due in part to their efforts in the ongoing. Just want to talk a little bit about our living laboratory. So certainly with FAST, having our assistive technology center in our AAC lab, everything is co-located. So on a daily basis, Carolyn, students, colleagues are in the ongoing seeing folks coming in to deliver AAC services and related assistive technology services. So providing those activities really keeps us grounded in the reality of what it is to provide these types of services and supports in the community. Disclosures in terms of funding for the work that will be discussed today. It's across a range of funders over a number of years. So certainly want to give a shout out to all of that support that really allows us to not only offer community-based programs, but also then to measure the outcomes and really refine our procedures that we're going to talk to you about today as an example of a communication partner supports that can be provided. So as you saw, as you looked over the sessions within this series, our learning objectives for today are to describe at least a protocol for communication partner instruction in AAC, and we're going to discuss one example today. There are certainly others. This is not the only approach that can be taken, but it is the one that we have been developing and refining over I used to say a number of years, but I guess I better start saying a number of decades at this point. It's been going on so long. So we're also going to talk about a strategy for selecting communication partner skills that you would want to focus on with specific communication partners that you may be working with and that are relevant to the clients' lives that you're involved with. So first, we're going to kind of set the stage and talk a little bit about the background, the barriers that individuals using AAC may face in their communication. We know that communication spans all areas of language or all aspects of language. So if you're going to experience communication success, whether you be a child, an adult, at any age, you really need to have skills in each of these domain areas. So not a surprise to our speech language pathologists who may be joining us here today, but if you have relevant content to what you want to talk about, but you don't have relevant grammar to allow someone to understand what it is you're saying, that can present a challenge for you, just as one example. Of course, we have pragmatic concerns, which are of great interest when we're talking about adult clients, the way we may conduct ourselves in one context versus another with one type of very close friend versus someone who is not necessarily as central in our lives is going to affect pragmatically how it is that we communicate. So all of these aspects really come into relevance as we're looking at supporting communication success. When we're talking about supporting communication partners, really, if you look across the literature, historically, there's been a lot more focus on improving pragmatic skills or affecting interventions that will support communication partners to really address those pragmatic elements. Not as much focus, although we're seeing that coming into more recent years, where we're able to support not only the pragmatic skills of an individual who's using AAC through communication partner instruction, but really across the range of skills. And some of the things that we addressed last week, if you had joined us in talking about the different types of language interventions that we've been investigating, we're really trying to make that connection to support our communication partners who are with these individuals day in and day out to be able to provide those supports as well so that they have more consistent, coordinated, and streamlined supports across their day. So we have a number, of course, of contributing factors when we talk about communication success. So certainly the intrinsic factors that may be relevant to the client and the specifics of what their situation might be. So what their cognitive skills are, what their motor skills are, what is the event that caused a particular challenge when it comes to communication. And whether that be something that's acquired, obviously that's going to result in a change in what the person is used to in terms of the skills that they relied upon to support their communication, or whether it be developmental, so a lifelong situation where they are facing some barriers or some challenges as a result of their intrinsic factors. Then we have our sort of environmental factors, if you will. So if we start to look at what are the communication opportunities for this individual, and we're focusing on adults today, as you've heard, we have a great focus in our research on children, but it's just the same whatever the age of the client. If there are not really relevant and meaningful or motivating communication opportunities, then we're not going to see that same level of success that we might expect when it is an appropriate context with appropriate opportunities for communicating. Another challenge that, of course, we need to consider is really whether the person has access to appropriate AAC technologies and supports. And as I mentioned, that's certainly something that is a significant focus in the center that we have at UCF, and looking at providing access to the relevant technologies and different options that a person can access to support their communication through a multimodal approach. The reality is that we do have a lot more control over the extrinsic or environmental factors. We can often help to support rapid progress in communication success when we tackle those extrinsic factors. So today we're going to talk a lot about, I've mentioned here, working with school teams, working with teams that are in other adult-focused contexts, et cetera. We're going to talk about those others that wrap around in the person's environment. So we're going to have that focus on the extrinsic and those communication partners, whether they, whatever type of team environment it might be, and in the personal environment of that person. Okay, so we're going to, in a sense, help to compensate, we hope, for some of those intrinsic factors by providing our communication partners with options to support their loved one or the person that they're working with. Okay, so providing communication opportunities. We know that communication partners really are the key to our everyday lives. If we were living in isolation, it would be much less interesting. And as we all experienced when we were thrown into the pandemic and how quickly we grasped onto options like this, like Zoom, where we were still able to have those ongoing interactions with others. That's a really important thing. So we know that these individuals play a variety of roles in the lives of our clients. And certainly when we think about adults in particular, they have the close family unit. And in many situations, that may be a life partner, a spouse, somebody who is very central to everything that is happening in their everyday lives. They may have children in the family. They may have other family members living in the home, et cetera. So a lot of communication in the home environment in the ongoing. of course, we extend out from there and we're thinking about the context of an adult client and having friends, other relatives, family members, whether they be close or whether they be at a significant distance. And again, I think that some of those things, maybe we even have more close relationship and ongoing one-to-one communication since the pandemic than we did previously when it comes to individuals who are or family members who are living at a distance, because we've really come to incorporate these types of interactions in the ongoing. Of course, any adult in day-to-day navigating through environments is going to come in contact with a number of acquaintances, people that you're not necessarily as close with, but it's still very important to communicate with, whether that be in a work environment or a social environment or just out around town. Depending on the situation of the person, they may be interacting a good deal with paid personnel. So that may be healthcare workers across a very full spectrum of services being provided in addition to medical services. And then of course the unfamiliar partners that we're all going to encounter and that make everyday life very interesting when we meet new people. So all of those things we really want to consider and make sure that the supports that we're providing in how to guide our very significant communication partners of our clients, how we can guide them to support interactions to be effective and to achieve communicative confidence across this full range of communication partner categories. So when we think about working with communication partners, some of these less than ideal things might come to mind based on your experiences as you're meeting the communication partners of clients you're working with. In many cases, these individuals may dominate interaction or take a lot of the conversational turns, and particularly if this is something that was an acquired event, this may have been a very dramatic shift in the way the significant others are communicating with adults after whether it be a traumatic brain injury or some other type of acquired event, stroke, et cetera. All of a sudden, these communication partners may be scrambling to fill in that space that they're not used to filling in. So they really may be stepping in, and particularly when our clients are interacting with their healthcare providers, sometimes we see that even more when those communication partners really want to jump in, take over, and sort of move the conversation along, if you will. So you may be seeing examples of these communication partners not providing a lot of opportunities for initiation or even for their loved one to respond, for example, when they do have conversation or ask questions. They might end up asking a lot of yes/no questions, interrupting, and they may be very highly focused on the technology, particularly if it's something that's really new that was introduced to the everyday life of the client and the family and significant others. It may not be something that they're used to sort of managing within that communication context. So in turn, the literature has told us for a good number of years that our clients can end up being rather passive in their communication. We can sometimes end up dealing with situations of learned helplessness over time, where they really just sort of retreat and give in to some of those more dominating type approaches, particularly when it comes to adult interactions and adult communication partners. So they may end up not initiating very much, not responding even as much as they might have in the beginning. And they may end up producing a limited number of communicative functions. So nothing can be more frustrating, I think, than only being able to talk about your needs and your wants and demands, if you will, in the ongoing. Of course, those things are important and we need to be able to talk about them, but certainly not the main focus of what is of interest to us in ongoing communication as adults. So all of those things, of course, give us concern for our clients. in many cases are the communication expectations, and if it is an adult who is still in with a developmental disability, for example, who's still in a language learning phase, in many cases we see that the expectations are set quite low. And even in cases where we see the profile of a client where they, we know they can communicate at a more active, in a more active capacity, they can communicate at a higher level. In some cases, it's really the, whether it be the providers or the significant others, when it comes to the communication partners, that just have sort of given up on what the expectations are, or just kept, if not completely given up, kept them at a quite low level. So we need to figure out a way that we can provide relevant supports and that is going to end up yielding a change in the communication part patterns and outcomes for this client that we're working with. Okay, so if we're underestimating expressive capability, and that certainly can happen to any of us as providers, as well as other communication partners, in many instances, the situation is that they're lacking the tools, which of course we need to be concerned about. We need to make sure that they have the relevant communication technology that they need, but that they also have that expectation that they can do more, that they can communicate at a higher level and achieve more success and sort of satisfaction in their communication. Now, there certainly can be exceptions to this, for example. So we may continue to have clients that we work with significant disabilities who are at a pre-symbolic level. So perhaps they're not ready to be using aided communication, for example, and symbols to represent messages and the meaning that they want to deliver. So I'm not trying to say that for every possible client out there, it's only a matter of providing them with the appropriate tools and the expectation to communicate that the magic will appear. That may not be the case in all situations, and we may need to work on a full range of skills for a person to be able to take advantage of the power of aided communication. So that's where we come into looking at how can we help our communication partners to change how they can interact with students or clients who are using AAC. So we're going to talk about opportunities and how we can teach communication partners in natural contexts how to provide those supports for our clients. So we started to touch on a little bit of this. We want to make sure that we're talking about motivating contexts. Some contrived contexts are not particularly motivating to children, and they're certainly not necessarily motivating to adults either. So those are things that we really need to be concerned about. Thinking about what is important to this person, what is the context that they are really just itching to be able to communicate more effectively and get their messages delivered. That's really something that we're going to want to focus on as a starting point. We certainly need to ensure that the person has access to appropriate vocabulary. If they are literate and they are able to type out their messages letter by letter, et cetera, of course that gives them an incredible amount of power to access whatever vocabulary, whatever phrasing, whatever approach to communication they might want. But that may not be the case for all of our adult clients. We do need to consider what is it that can be effective to represent language if they're using an aided AAC system. So we talked about the expectation for success and the expectation to keep improving. And in many cases with our adult clients, if you're seeing them, it's because they are very motivated and their significant communication partners are very motivated in seeking services and looking to find those supports to have a higher level of communicative competence achieved. Okay, so some common kind of frustrating aspects of working with communication partners. So we've certainly all been in situations with our adult clients where their communication partners are interacting in those less than ideal ways, as we mentioned. So they may be talking too much, asking too many questions, not providing them with even wait time to be able to respond. Sometimes as the clinician, we might offer some suggestions. We might check back in and say, ask, how are things going with the things that we talked about at our last session, for example. And in many cases, we get a quick response from those communication partners because they may not feel comfortable really letting you know about the challenges that they are experiencing. So that sometimes results in the unchanged interactions that we see in the brief time that we are accompanying the client. In some cases, the partner may end up feeling very inadequate, not because they feel like, well, you know, a suggestion was made by a clinician as to what I should do and how I should do it, and it's not working for me. I'm not really seeing a difference in those communicative interactions. And then the client, you as the clinician may also sort of feel frustrated. So that really doesn't leave a great intersection there. And these are the types of things that we want to try to overcome by focusing directly on communication partner instruction in addition to our client interventions. So we do know that changing any kind of behavior, particularly in adults, is difficult. If sticking to my, you know, clean eating routine is any kind of indication, I can tell you that those types of things, whether it be communication related or any other daily routine, it really does take time. It takes repetition. It takes instruction in some cases. And that's what we're going to focus on today as we look at how can we provide support through instruction when it comes to being a supportive communication partner. Another key thing is to really select those partner techniques carefully. And this is something that in the early years of communication partner work that Kathy and I did, we didn't talk a lot about that. We really talked more about the instructional sequence and how we could set up support very directly in working with the communication partner. We often tend to skip over how is it that we select what we're going to focus on with a given communication partner. And we've kind of been talking through some of those elements today to make sure that it's something that they care about, something that's relevant and meaningful to them is very important. But we did get a good bit of feedback, and we're always interested in hearing about clinicians' experiences in implementing our interventions. And we are fortunate. We have such an incredible, really worldwide community of clinicians who are so focused on doing the best possible that they can for their clients with complex communication needs. And they reach out and give us feedback on or let us know about things that they're having challenges with, et cetera. So that's really what led to sort of this next component of what we're going to talk about is selecting those skills to target through communication partner instruction really came very directly from feedback from the clinician community. So we kind of stepped through loose guidelines, if you will, for selecting partner skills. And the first is focusing on the client outcomes during those instructional sessions. So it's fine to change the communication behavior of a communication partner, but if it doesn't yield a change in the actual client, then we're wasting everyone's time. And that's definitely not what we want. So we really want to look at the techniques that we can implement for a given client that will result in a change to how the partner is, or to how the client is able to communicate. We want to try to start somewhere where we can affect change quickly so that we don't frustrate our communication partners, so that we can jump right in and we can start to see some improved communication and hopefully overall improved satisfaction in daily life. We want to practice the selected partner techniques with the client ourselves as the clinician before we start suggesting that this is something that you definitely need to do in communicating with a X client. So we want to make sure that we're able to identify any pitfalls or any challenges that may come up in that. And we definitely want to start small and expand to a more broad communication context or more broad communication opportunities, if you will, over time. Okay, so some of the things that we want to consider, the first block here is something that may stand out to us right away, sort of how the partner is failing to facilitate communication. So sometimes that's just so jarring to us that it's so obvious when we see something that they're doing and we think, oh gosh, they would just change this one thing, that would make a big difference. But then we want to move on to, okay, so what are the exact behaviors that would be more facilitative? And if that's replacing one particular tendency or approach with another, that in many cases can be very effective as well. And then we look at, of course, what are the outcomes, as I mentioned. So going from the, what do we want to get rid of? What do we want to do instead? And then what is that going to yield for the actual client? So we're going to talk about our impact program, and these are sort of the things that we would suggest that you start to consider as you're looking at selecting a partner skill that you want to focus on with a given communication partner. So we want to find something that we can really define explicitly. If we sort of throw out loose suggestions to communication partners, it often doesn't work very well. We want to make sure that we're able to eliminate the least helpful partner behaviors immediately or most quickly. As I mentioned, we want to do things that can be acquired quickly by the partner, change the client outcomes and the communication effectiveness quickly. We can identify and measure, and that we want to focus on things that can be used across at least a couple of highly specific contexts. So if we provide support for something that is relevant to the communication partner and the client once a year, that's probably not going to be a place that we necessarily want to start. We really want to start with things that are high frequency, motivating, and important to both the communication partner and the client. So I mentioned this aspect of practicing before you ask the partner to do it with the client. And this is really the opportunity for you to get an idea of what are the range of client responses or behaviors that might come up in response to implementing a given technique, so that you can help troubleshoot those things before your communication partner experiences them. So whether that be a level of frustration, for example, that the client experiences to the point that they just get up and walk away, as opposed to really working through the situation. And that's certainly something that could come up with our adult clients. If that's the case, then we want to think ahead to supports that we can provide and suggestions that we can give to the communication partner before they experience that, which can be upsetting to them when they're working hard to try to change something or implement something themselves to be supportive, and then they just experience complete denial or refusal to participate by the client. So I mentioned these highly specific contexts. It's a lot easier for our communication partners when we're asking them to do something that they're obviously going to know. It's just going to be very apparent to them when they need to use the skill that we're asking them to implement. So that's why we suggest the 1 to 2 specific contexts to get started. And as much as possible for these to be contexts that are short in duration, so that if there needs to be sort of a stepwise approach, they're not stuck in a situation that is extremely frustrating for an extended period of time. Okay, so in some cases, we know we really want to change a lot, but we have to think about starting small and then expanding out so that we don't frustrate the communication partner as well. Okay, so a couple of example contexts. So for example, if you had a married senior citizen age a client with aphasia, and you might want to start with some at-home conversation where we're looking at if it's a situation where the person has some specific desires or needs when it comes to selecting what they want to eat or where they want to eat, et cetera. If that's something that is common and comes up repeatedly for them, that's something we might want to consider. We might want to then work up to how can we teach the communication partner to provide supports for that individual then going ahead and ordering their meal in a restaurant, which is probably something that they did if this is a common outing for this particular couple that they did all the time. So that would be something that would be important to them in many cases to be able to regain that skill, to be able to interact in that way with someone different. So if we start sort of small and what's relevant through a meal-related conversation at home, then we expand out to additional communication partners. If we have a young adult who's living in a family context and there's conversation in the home or in a repeated community outing type context, so whatever that might be, if that is attending a church service or other worship service that happens repeatedly and the ongoing, then that may be a context that we want to start with, where we have those familiar communication partners really are the central ones that would be engaging in the communication interaction, versus then expanding out to a conversation with a more broad group of friends, perhaps in that same environment or in a different environment. So really not jumping to the end game where the person is feeling more comfortable interacting with a large group of people, et cetera, starting a little smaller with the communication partners that are in the ongoing and with a little bit more limited communication context, and then expanding out. Okay, so if we've got our communication partner skills that we want to target, after you've selected those, then we want to move into, okay, we know what we want to change. We know what we want our communication partner to do. Then how is it that we're going to do it? And that's where we shift into the approach that we have developed and been evaluating over a number of years to look at how can we teach and support our communication partners to implement those skills. So there are a number of articles that are published and really just a link provided at the end of the presentation to many articles that have looked at evaluating this particular approach can help to understand this process. But there is an article in the ASHA SIG 12 Perspectives publication that really gives sort of a quick and dirty overview, if you will, of these different steps that we use within our communication partner instruction protocol that sometimes people find to be effective. So the background on this program, we know we have a need for this, and you know, we're going back to the early days of AAC implementation where this was identified as a priority area. And over the years, as more intervention studies have come out that have focused on communication partners, we've seen that systematic reviews and meta-analyses that have been conducted have indicated to us, not only can we teach communication partners to effectively alter their communication behaviors and really implement the skills or strategies that we suggest, but also that we then see positive outcomes when it comes to our clients' communication. So IMPACT stands for Improving Partner Applications of Augmentative Communication Techniques. And it was developed quite some number of years ago, really growing out of the education literature and how to teach other types of systematic skills. So whether that be how to solve a complex math problem or write a particular type of narrative, et cetera, there really is a literature base that shows us how we can teach others to implement individual skills and sort of put them together within a systematic strategy approach. So we were originally focused on facilitating early language and communication outcomes for young children who are using AAC, but that certainly has been adapted and documented to have positive outcomes with adults as well as with children. So the information that I'm going to give you on the evidence that we've been collecting over the years, of course, does focus on children because that's the main focus area of our line of research. But other researchers, other clinicians have adapted the protocol and used it to support the communication partners of adults as well. So to date, we've worked with parents across varying cultural and linguistic groups or backgrounds. We've worked with educators, a range of folks in the school and related educational environment. And we have worked with same age peers of elementary school age children. So that's sort of the scope, as I said, of the work that we have done. But there is certainly are examples in the literature of doing this with adult communication partners. We have done this in two sort of contexts. So one, the more direct one-on-one individual kind of instruction scenario where we're able to work side by side with a particular communication partner or couple of communication partners that are relevant to our clients' lives. And we've also done this in a group instruction approach. So in these cases, the contexts were school in service or day camp type environments where a group of parents are coming together or a group of educators or service providers are together and we're able to provide instruction and support starting from that group context and then narrowing into some, of course, individualized feedback, practice, supports within that approach. This has been done in long-term care facilities, for example, when it comes to communication partners who are interacting with individuals with complex communication needs on a daily basis in those environments. And, you know, as we've all seen or can imagine, you know, those can really bring up some very repeated frustrating experiences if we don't have effective communication that can be facilitated between those care providers, service providers, and the individuals in that type of daily environment. So that's something that is sort of akin to the group instruction type approach that we've used with children and has been transferred over to use with adults in other settings. In our case, you see a range of what were the primary diagnoses of those individuals that we were working with, of these kids. So you see sort of an age range up to entering into adolescence from very young age, where we were working with the relevant communication partners. And this is certainly not an exhaustive list, but just some examples of some elements of the profiles of the clients of the that we were focused on within our intervention studies. So our evidence-based strategy that we have been employing in various ways has a number of skills that comprise that strategy. And one that I'm sure doesn't surprise you is aided AAC modeling. So using the communication device or a companion device to provide models of effective AAC use. So that is something that has been integral within the strategy that we have taught communication partners to employ. We've also taught communication partners to employ expectant delay, so that there is enough time and communication space that a person can interact and use their aided communication device to be able to communicate. And we focus on the support of the aided communication approach, but we certainly are advocating at all times multimodal communication. So there may be speech approximations, there may be signs mixed in, et cetera. But within the studies that we've done, all of the participants have had some form of aided communication aid that they were using. We've taught our communication partners to ask open-ended questions. And of course, yes, no questions are relevant in all of our daily lives, but not the only type of question asking that is relevant. So we have had a focus on that. We've taught our communication partners to provide verbal prompts. And whether that be even just the supportive when it comes to an adult, you know, why don't you order? Or if you're in a restaurant, as we used that example earlier, as opposed to just jumping in and placing the order for our client as an example. So it might be something very simple, or it may be more pointed towards redirecting our client toward the device if they have that present to use, et cetera. And then we have focused on increased responsivity. So whether that be something that we consider to be an appropriate utterance or a communicative event from our client or inappropriate, whatever it is, we still need to be able to respond to it and not ignore things. And again, this is particularly relevant when it comes to adults. We really need to provide that support for our communication partners so that they are not just consistently ignoring things because they might be unexpected or they might be more difficult for them to understand than perhaps they were in the past if it was an acquired situation. But really focusing on that responsivity piece and making sure that it is contingent upon what the individual has attempted to communicate, even if it wasn't successful. So you see an example here of our strategy and the way we put together those different elements of the different skills that go into implementing the strategy that we're suggesting. You see this example is written in a pediatric context for a storybook reading activity. So what we have taught our communication partners to do, and whether that be a parent, an educator, another child at school during library time, et cetera, we've taught them to, on a given page when they're reading a storybook, and this would be a storybook situation with pictures in it as well as text. We've taught them to read whatever the text might be or some variation of it that would be appropriate to the receptive language level of the client. We've taught them to read it while modeling use of the AAC system, whatever that aided system is. We teach the communication partner to then pause in case in that case, we're talking about a child, what might draw their interest on the page of the storybook, whether that be a picture or something that is relevant to the actual storyline. And in many cases, it might not be. But we've taught them to pause so that there can be some initiation. If the child doesn't respond or say anything, then we teach our communication partners to ask an open-ended question while, again, modeling use of the system so that it gives the child a little bit more leeway or control to take this conversation in a direction that might be of interest to them. We teach them then to pause if there's not a response and to model an appropriate response or answer to that question if the child is not able to do so. If at any point the child says anything, then we teach the communication partner to just respond contingently. The point is not to go down from step to step to step here within the strategy and implement every possible step. Those are really set up in a least to most prompting approach. So where we're providing the more naturalistic cue and then the more heavy-handed cues sort of increase as necessary. We're always wanting to fade those away as our client doesn't need the more direct supports. And of course, really focusing on that response piece. So you see at the bottom, we have rah, 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 which is the mnemonic that we use to help our communication partners remember those individual aspects or individual skills that go into implementing this strategy. So read, ask, and answer in that case is what makes up the rah. And we teach our communication partners that no matter what step you're implementing, whether it be read, ask, or answer, you're always providing models of using the aided AAC device. So that's where that mnemonic comes from. Another piece that might be added here is sometimes we use wrap where we provide a prompt at the end. So if we still are not getting any interaction, then we move to a more direct prompt. So it might be wrap instead of raw. But whatever the acronym is that might help, or mnemonic is that might help a person to remember what those individual skills are, we want not a lot of cognitive effort on the part of the communication partner to going into remembering these individual steps. We really want them engaging in the communicative interaction in a appropriate manner. So that's why we do practice using those types of supports. So these are the 8 steps that are suggested within our instructional sequence of the impact program. And when first looking at this diagram, it can seem maybe a little overwhelming and like, okay, am I going to need 8 hours or 80 hours to implement this approach? But really our research has shown that that's not necessary. We're able to do a number of these steps within one session that can be as brief as 20 to 30 minutes, or it might be longer, it might be up to an hour or so, depending on the communication style, the preferences, the related conversation that might come up, particularly when we're talking about the communication partners of adults. That might sort of guide the length of an individual session. But I'm going to just briefly step through what each of these suggested elements within the instructional sequence really is targeting and what it might yield. So the first step of pretesting and getting a commitment from the communication partner is just really trying to provide, be upfront with the communication partner to give them information on what is it that we're doing? Why are we doing it? And then what's the meaning to my loved one or the client that I'm working with, et cetera. So we tend to provide some sort of with and without examples in video format of interactions with a client, and in some cases with that actual client when possible, of interacting without implementing any kind of supports, and then interacting and looking at what are the communication outcomes for the client when we do implement those types of supports or a given strategy like we were just looking at an example of. So we talk about the differences between the videos and really, okay, what does this translate to in terms of meaning for their loved one or the client that they're focused on? And that's why we're doing it, just so that there are no surprises as to what's involved and what the purpose is. Our next step is to provide a detailed description of the strategy. And I just gave you an example where I talked through an overview of what an example strategy might look like. And it looked very similar to that, where we're just, again, perhaps using a visual aid and talking about what each component of the strategy is that we're going to be teaching them. Our third step is strategy demonstration, and that's where we're modeling use of the targeted strategy that we are asking them to learn or working with them to teach them. And we're in many cases providing sort of think aloud statements. So, you know, in the case of working with a parent of a child in the storybook reading context, I would read the text, I would be modeling using the AAC system, and then I would say something like, okay, now I've read a little bit of the story and I'm just gonna wait. I'm gonna count in my head whatever length of time might be relevant or appropriate for that particular child or client. And I'm gonna see if you say anything. And you haven't said anything. So now I'm gonna go ahead and ask you a question. So those are the types of think aloud statements that we use to just explain why we're doing something so that it's very obvious to the communication partner. And in many cases with adults, it can be a little awkward for them to do that type of role play. So when we provide that sort of companion instruction and discussion on what it is that we're doing, that sort of takes away some of the awkwardness. interestingly with kids, that they're always happy to do role play. So it's not as as awkward for them, if you will. But that's something that we provide for multiple reasons. The next step four is to provide the verbal practice of the strategy steps. And that's exactly as I was mentioning before, whether it be RAW that we're using, read, ask, answer, or RAP, read, ask, answer, prompt. This is where we literally do rote verbal rehearsal of read, ask, answer, et cetera. We say that over and over again so that it just becomes very automatic for the person. That's the same reason that we all use mnemonics at some point, probably in our education, when we're trying to learn a multi-step sequence or something that just really sticks in your head and helps you remember. The next step is the controlled practice step. And that's where the role play involves the partner being themselves or playing themselves within the role play. And you are playing the role of the client in that case. So in this step, what we typically do is provide the communication partner with a lot of opportunity to go through all of the steps in the strategy. So we're very passive communicators in our role play as we play the role of the client initially. So we give them practice of going through all of the steps. Then when they're really showing some success and comfort with that, then we start jumping in and doing things that in our observation of that particular client, they might do in how they might respond, what type of question they might ask, you know, what type of behavior might come up, et cetera. So we start doing that to give the communication partner some practice with it before they're live in an interaction with their with the client. Excuse me. Our next step is our advanced practice, and that's where we bring the client into the situation, and we set up some kind of interaction, again, that's going to be meaningful, not just making things up for the sake of making things up, but having an interaction where the communication partner is then practicing, implementing the skills and putting them together within the strategy through that interaction. And we're there as the clinician support to give feedback and suggestions, et cetera, and participate in the conversation. We don't just sort of leave them hang out to dry for no reason and step back and, you know, take data on what they're doing right and wrong. This is real life. This is real interaction. So we are there as a support. So the post-test and commitment is something that, you know, obviously in our research studies, we're very formal in terms of how we need to record data, measure change over time, et cetera. But even in the ongoing clinical context, it's really worth taking that time, particularly when we're talking about adult communication partners, to look back at, you know, here's where we were and here's where we are now. And when you've seen that positive change and the increased success when it comes to the communicative interactions, then it's very encouraging in many instances and motivating for the communication partner to remember to keep those skills at their disposal and those strategies that you've taught in the ongoing so that they can expand out. And whatever context where you've practiced it, obviously you're not going to be necessarily out side by side with that communication partner and client out in the community, but talking about where it is that they can implement and make use of these strategies in other communication environments. So that brings us to our last step of the generalization, which again, these are terms that you know, we're using in a more formal sense when it comes to running a research study, but something that we're just as concerned about in the ongoing when it's a clinical context. So it's fine and dandy if there's a effective communicative interaction in the little clinic room, but we really want to make sure that these are the types of experiences and successes that our clients and their communication partners are experiencing in their everyday contexts and lives in the community. So that brings us to the end of our sequence, if you will. So as I said, there are a number of steps, but they can be put together within one session. So in many cases, we do those first five steps in one session. So that might be taken care of in less than an hour. And then we come back for the additional practice sessions and support, et cetera, which in most cases will likely be paired with your direct intervention that you're providing to your client as well. So this is just a sample data set where we see, in this case, it's a parent and child investigation. And what we're looking at when it comes to the dark boxes is the parent's implementation of the strategy for the communication partner intervention strategy. Not surprising, clearly none of them were implementing it before we started because they certainly didn't know anything about those four steps and putting them together in that way. This is not surprising, but what is encouraging is the fact that, you know, after a couple of hours, between even less than 2 hours and up to 5 hours, that we can have communication partners who are then implementing these types of supportive strategies at a very high success rate. So, you know, 100% of the time, they were implementing the strategy in the way that it was taught and the way it was intended for use. So that's pretty good bang for our buck. And then we see correspondingly, in this case, a child client, a pediatric client, in the beginning, they were not taking any communication turns. So the first two kids were taking almost none or one or two. Our third child was maybe in 20% of opportunities. And in this case, we're talking about a storybook reading situation. So that would be on 20% or less of pages read. Did the child say anything or talk about anything about the story? So then we see a corresponding jump. So in 100% of the cases or close to it, the child is interacting, talking about the story, et cetera. And that's something that is important when it comes to emergent literacy, moving into literacy development, et cetera. So for a child, that context makes sense. When you're talking about an adult, obviously you're looking at a full range of varied contexts, but it's just an example of how with a small amount of time that is focused on the communication partner, what kind of changes we can see in the communication patterns of our clients. In this case, it just goes into a little more detail with those same kids, looking at, okay, well, were they just saying the same word every time you turned the page? Is that all they were saying? So you see that over time, they're jumping up from using maybe one or two words or less than 10 words to an increased number of different concepts that they were communicating about, et cetera. These are young children, so that's what we're talking about, number of words, et cetera. When it comes to adults, you may have a different benchmark, but just looking at, okay, what was the meaning behind the change in their communicative patterns? And we certainly can see very encouraging and important changes that yield increased communicative competence. So far we have looked at tackling pragmatic skills of the clients who have participated in our studies. We have looked at tackling really skills across all of the domains of language. So we've taught our communication partners to support advances in pragmatic syntax, semantics, morphology, et cetera, when we've really been very specific in what we targeted. So what did we teach our communication partners to support to help our, in these cases, children learn to communicate at a higher level? So it doesn't just have to be that they take more communicative turns, and that in many cases is a great starting point, because if they're not communicating at all, that's something we're concerned about. But it may be much more fine-tuned as we're trying to support their overall communication growth. And we can absolutely teach our communication partners to support those things, to go hand in hand with the direct interventions that we provide to the child themselves. Or to the adult, whether that be the case. So some ongoing work in this area, certainly Carolyn and Nancy and Poonam and other colleagues in the clinic will talk about the immediate jumping into doing this in a distance format through telehealth, et cetera, that was very, very relevant during the pandemic when everything shifted to a telehealth service delivery model. So certainly important to be able to provide those supports and can be extremely convenient as we see, and we can have increased attendance and compliance and et cetera when it can be more convenient for our communication partners as well as for our clients. So we need to make sure that we're responsive to sort of the overall clinical service delivery context. And these are issues that come up for clinicians. So we had a fairly recent publication that came out of the wonderful work of a doctoral student in our school who was looking at adapting the use of the IMPACT program with parents of young children through a hybrid service delivery model. So some of the communication partner intervention was provided in person and some of it was provided via distance, as you see an example of a photo on the screen here. So lots of that continuing to happen. And I am probably well past my time here because we need to jump in to talk about some cases or situations that you all might want to discuss. But the bottom line is we really feel strongly that providing this type of support or intervention, whatever you want to call it, for communication partners and combining that with our client interventions, and that includes both the clinical interventions as well as providing the relevant technology and aided supports that can help an individual with complex communication needs to communicate in their environments. Combining all of those things really yields to increase communicative competence or communication success or satisfaction, et cetera, based on the work that we've been doing, both on the research side and also in the ongoing clinical space within our center and communication disorders clinic on campus. So I think that brings me to conclusion, if you want to jump in, ladies.
Absolutely. Does anyone have any questions to kick off for Dr. Kent-Walsh? One of the questions I had, and perhaps you kind of started to answer it actually, was I know a lot when working with adults that we see here in the clinic, as you mentioned, we run into the issues of not all of the stakeholders occur in the same setting. So they have partners that are just in the context of employment or a day program, caregivers who are only communicating with them in the home. So thinking of strategies to get some collaboration on setting those goals. And you did start to address the telehealth option, which potentially maybe is a solution to that, but I wanted to see what your thoughts were.
Yeah, well, I mean, you probably can provide even a more comprehensive response than I can. But I mean, I really think that convenience factor. And if we just think about, service delivery in general, the more it's placing an additional burden on people who are already challenged to support that client in whatever way or provide services or whatever role they play in that person's life, the more we increase that burden, I think the less likelihood we have of buy-in, et cetera. And none of this is done, for our benefit, right? It's really done for the benefit of the client. So the more we can be efficient in reaching those, the full range of communication partners, I think the more success we will experience. And whether that be a combination of being able to do, a quick Zoom, and not everybody has a full hour of time to put aside to talk to the clinician about A, B, or C. So it might have to be in short intervals. Also looking at combining that with sort of, if you're talking about, and I'm sorry, I forget, Carolyn, what context you mentioned, but if it's a situation in a group home or in a long-term care facility, et cetera, where we can do more of a workshop type approach that is offered during lunch or what have you, the same type of thing that we try to accomplish through the ECHO model, where people can briefly step out of what it is that they need to do in the ongoing and maybe get some tidbits of support is I think most realistic.
Yes, and we definitely saw that, certainly using the Zoom method and telehealth during pandemic, as you alluded to, we saw, anecdotally saw an increase in caregiver and partner participation in sessions because there was a necessity to be there to help facilitate equipment and all sorts of things. In previous sessions, we've had from the community suggestions around creating Google Docs and surveys and things, trying to capture that data from those caregivers that could be sent to them to be completed. And I was curious if that was ever something that you had done in any of these projects or studies as a way to kind of collect information.
So we have on site, not so something that was done as part of, for example, the summer camp or the school personnel coming together. So we've done it in the moment as a part of that. But doing it to reach people who are not there in that context is not something that we've looked at from the research perspective, but makes a lot of sense. And again, the convenience, the factor of being able to, if the time that they can do it is at, 7 in the morning when they first clock in, or what have you, like that's the part that we need to address. And not have unrealistic expectations that it's going to happen at, 2 p.m. at an appointment time, et cetera. So I think the more that we can look at how do we address the convenience, get the relevant information that allows us to tailor the supports that we provide, the more success we'll have.
Absolutely. Any other questions for Dr. Kent-Walsh or ideas from the groups of things that you all have tried in order to increase partner engagement or work with partners on trainings on these specific topics?
We always learn so much from hearing about your applications and the challenges, just as well as the success stories.
This isn't so much a question, more of a thought, but I do work with adults with developmental disabilities, and I'm really lucky that I work in a setting where we have lots of time and we have access to video and all of those things. It's not weird for us to turn on a video and record something, but I'm just thinking about this intervention and how it might work for someone who's in a different setting, like a school. I guess they have to work, the scheduling issue with the communication partner is probably certainly a gigantic barrier, but I also wonder just about how easy it is to implement the things like the role playing and the video things when you're so separate typically from your clients' caregivers. And I'm assuming in a school you probably need permission to video and then to release the video and all of those things, and just how complicated that must feel for those clinicians in that setting.
All of those things, absolutely. And we definitely ran into every bit of that in running our studies, and really needed to sort of not put the cart before the horse. So we needed to have buy-in, not just from a teacher or a paraprofessional or whoever who was interested in getting support. We needed to work with the school administration to really talk with them about what we were doing, how we were doing it. Of course, because it's research, that's a whole other element. And in many cases, you have approval from the school district to implement the study within the school context. But even going beyond all of those sort of legal requirements, really, we found that you can't underestimate the importance of working alongside all of the relevant players within that context for them to understand what are we doing, why are we doing it. And in many cases, they go beyond the expectations, has been our experience in setting things up to make it doable. So it's not just that, any teacher or paraprofessional is sitting around with oodles of free time during the day. Obviously, we know the demands are incredibly high, et cetera, but there are ways for example, for the administration to provide supports to get a little pocket of time here, there, to assign, part of a professional development day to a workshop that relates to this, et cetera. Those are all of kind of the necessary wraparound pieces to make it possible. And, certainly things have changed. I think about you know, recordings that we did in school settings 20 years ago versus some of the parameters, requirements, you can't just whip out your iPhone and start recording, although that might be really easy. You can't do that. You probably could 20 years ago, although we didn't have, you know, iPhones. You see all of the nuances that come up through this. And we really do need to think about those things and make sure that we don't cut our nose off to spite our face before we even get started, because we haven't gotten the necessary support, approvals, buy-in from those players to then be able to just concentrate on providing the actual support. But there's a lot of pre-work that needs to go into it. And if you're already a member of the school, so if you're a clinician, and I'm just picking up on your example that you were mentioning in the school context, if you're already a member of that community, it in some cases can be even easier to kind of go down that road than it is for an outside researcher, like, you know, we sometimes experience, to come into an environment where we're not an ongoing member of that community. And, you know, we need to establish those relationships and trust, et cetera, and show, okay, what's going to be the educational benefit of doing this, which is really, of course, what's of great concern to people in charge in those settings.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. It's great that you've had a better than expected response almost in seeing kind of administrators and other people in the school system going above and beyond. That's really great to hear. And that pre-planning piece is, that's what I was thinking. It doesn't sound like something you could just like take one training, grab a manual and implement the next day, because there is a lot of pre-planning, potentially a lot of pre-planning, depending on your setting, before you actually start even planning for your client and their communication partner.
I so appreciate you bringing that up. I mean, those are exactly the elements that, you know, are really important in the everyday clinical context to consider. So I really appreciate you pointing that out. And I will say that, you know, it's not every environment that somebody's willing to go the extra mile. So there are definitely some stories on the very opposite end of the spectrum where it's been a very significant challenge for these children to get the support they need in a school context. So,
yeah. And this is super off topic, but I just have to say, I'm a former student of yours, and it's really fun to see you on the screen again.
Oh, yay. Well, we always love to hear from our students.
That's probably cool. Like 2002, in the early 2000s, I was your student.
Okay, see, now you're telling everybody just how old I am.
Yeah, and how old I am.
Yeah, that's why when I start talking about the decades, it's like, how did that happen? But thanks so much.
Any other questions? All right. Well, I want to thank Dr. Kent-Walsh for her time today. Please reach out with any further questions or topics for discussion that you might have related to this topic. A couple of quick reminders. We do have a post-session survey that we're going to drop in the chat. We appreciate you completing that survey for us. And again, we're just looking at, now that you've been through the session, feedback on the topic, relevance, and if you anticipate it having any impact on your practice as we look to continue refining these offerings. Couple of reminders, next week, same time, we're going to have cultural considerations in AAC, somewhat hot topic recently. Dr. Alan Kahn is going to be our subject matter expert and has been actively preparing for this session, so we're greatly looking forward to it. If you do have a specific case study that you would like to bring to the group, feel free to submit that in advance and let us know, and we are happy to present that. That link is available to you both in the chat as well as on our ECHO website that is listed there below. As a brief reminder, we are sending out ASHA CE forms. You'll be receiving one for today if you haven't received one previously. You do only need to submit one. We're tracking attendance for the session, but we appreciate you returning those and your participation in general. Our contact information is available there. As always, please reach out with any questions, and we look forward to seeing some of you next week. Have a great week, everybody. Oh, Jillian, I apologize for the time difference. We will be posting the sessions to our YouTube channel. It'll be going up. We usually takes sometimes a day, depending on the length session, for it to come up into Zoom and to come down and Wi-Fi. So as soon as we have that, it'll be posted and made available publicly. Thank you, everybody.